hits him. What good news? What is the weapon? It is the name of the Lord. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. The channel that launches the name is the human mouth, out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants. Spiritual things find expression out of the mouth. This is true for both good and evil. Look at Revelation 16:13, for instance. John saw three impure spirits that looked like frogs. They came out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. Why does the psalmist refer to the mouth of babes and nursing infants? To show that we do not have to be spiritual giants. God has chosen the weak, the foolish, the despised, things to bring to naught all Satan's kingdom in the heavenly. In the Gospel of Matthew, we read that Jesus quoted this verse, Psalm 8:2, and gave us the interpretation. The Pharisees and the temple rulers had come to Jesus, complaining that there was too much noise in the temple. People were dancing, clapping their hands, singing hosannas, and it upset the religious leaders. So they said to Jesus, "Don't you hear what these children are saying?" they asked him. Jesus gave them this response, "Have you ever read, 'Out of the mouth of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise?'" Matthew 21:16. David wrote the words ordained strength. Jesus interpreted them as perfected praise. What does that tell us? That the ordained strength of God's people is perfect praise. When you praise the name of the Lord perfectly, you shut the devil up. Can you see, my friend, why the devil is so busy trying to keep you from praising the Lord? When you effectively, perfectly, with your whole heart, in unison, with one accord, praise the name of Jesus, it shuts the devil's mouth. And if ever there was a thing he does not like, it is to have his mouth shut. He will do everything he can, religious pressure, social pressure, fear of man, to keep you from turning loose in your prayers and praising the name of Jesus. Number 3. The blood of Jesus. Revelation 12:11 tells us, "They triumphed over him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony." Who are they? The believers on earth. Who is him? Satan. I want to emphasize the final victory does not come to God's angels, but the believers. This passage describes war in heaven. Michael and his angels are fighting. Satan and his angels are fighting. But the believers overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. By testifying continually about the blood of Jesus, they dislodged Satan from the heavenly. Is that not a tremendous revelation? Can you see, my good friend, why the devil will do anything he can to shut your mouth? Except when you gossip about your neighbors. But when you want to praise Jesus or utter the word of God or testify to what the Lord has done for you, Satan will put a barrier in front of your lips. Why? Because you are casting down his stronghold. We have another example of a spiritual battle in the Old Testament story of Jehoshaphat. In this battle, God's people gained total victory. Their enemy was utterly defeated. All they had to do was collect the spoils. I want to look briefly at Jehoshaphat's strategy, the weapons he had used, and how he gained this victory. I believe that every one of these principles and every one of these weapons applies exactly to us today. Number 4. Spiritual victory. Jehoshaphat was king of Judah. He had just brought the people back to God and re-established the temple's Mosaic system, the law, the priesthood, and the judges. He had done a fantastic job. Then he was threatened by an invasion of a vast host made up of Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, and others approaching his kingdom from the east, the direction of the Dead Sea. Jehoshaphat realized he and his people were outnumbered, and the enemy had such superiority of numbers and military power that they could not meet him merely on the natural plane. So Jehoshaphat and the children of Judah moved the battle out of the natural realm and into the spiritual realm. First, God's people fasted. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah, 2 Chronicles 20:3. God's people were confronted with a life or death issue. They stopped playing church and set themselves to seek the Lord. This was not a private individual fast. It was a collective fast of all of God's people confronted with the immediate danger of military defeat and possible extermination. They knew the last great resort of God's people is collective fasting. Second, they gathered together. Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Verse 4. In every major crisis in Israel's history, God's people forgot their differences and came together. The next thing was prayer. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem, at the temple of the Lord in the front new courtyard, and said, Lord, the God of our ancestors, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. Our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel, and give it to forever the descendants of Abraham, your friend? 2 Chronicles 20, 5-7. Notice that Jehoshaphat did not pray randomly. He prayed based on the written word of God as he knew it. He quoted God's word back to him. This is a good example of praying God's will and repeating to God what he has committed himself to do. Jehoshaphat prayed precisely that kind of prayer. He took God back to the history of his people, the Old Testament records, the law of Moses, the judges, the prophets. Jehoshaphat said, God, you promised thus and so. Now do it. Do as you have said. Next, as soon as he had finished praying, a prophecy came forth. Then the Spirit of the Lord came on Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jeel, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite and descendant of Asaph, as he stood in the assembly. He said, Listen, King Jehoshaphat and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem, verses 14 and 15. Wherever God's people fast and come together in praise, there always will be a prophetic revelation. After consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him for the splendor of his holiness as they went out at the head of the army, saying, Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. Verse 21. The forefront of this army was a group of priests praising and singing. I would believe they were doing a little dancing too. When they begin singing and praising, the Lord set ambushes against their enemies amid their praises, and the Lord dealt with the enemy. Oh, what a revelation! You minister to the Lord, he ministers to your problems. If God's people could only see this, our weapons are mighty through God. We reach up to God. We split that mid-heaven of darkness between us. God reaches down and touches whatever problems we face as nations and individuals. God will be just as faithful to us today as he was to Jehoshaphat and the children of Judah when we use the spiritual weapons that God has given us. Every enemy coming against them in battle was destroyed. It took 3 days to gather the spoil. They came back to Jerusalem with Jehoshaphat in front praising the Lord, and the fear of God fell on all the kingdoms round about. They had no more problems with military invasions from then on. See verses 25 through 30. Do you believe that can happen today? Do you think that believers can do this around the world? May the Lord give us just a little spiritual glimpse of his greatness and his glory. We have been given the weapons to cast Satan's kingdom down, and we are the ones who are going to do it. Where does he have his strongholds? Maybe in the very head offices of your government at this time. Perhaps there are men and women in vital administrative offices that are Satan's strongholds. Whose business is it to put them down? Ours. And we have been given the ammunition. The weapons of our warfare demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. Verse 5. This is what Paul said, For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 and 4. If we are involved in constant spiritual warfare against a spiritual enemy, it is evident that we must have spiritual weapons. Carnal weapons are of no use whatsoever for spiritual warfare. You cannot annihilate demons and rebellious angels out of the way with tanks. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we pray for your great mercy, that you guide us towards you, for we cannot find our way. And guide us to your will, to the need of our soul, for we cannot do it ourselves. And make our minds steadfast in your will and aware of our soul's need. Amen. We are creating an in-depth series on understanding prayers. If there is any question you have regarding prayer, put it down in the comments, and we will work on a video for you as soon as possible.